They tell me it's true, that it's never the perfect.
Good morning, church. Welcome, everyone. Whether you're here in the sanctuary or worshiping with us online, together we are the family of God, and it is good to be loving God, loving one another, and making disciples of Jesus, just as he has taught us to do. A special welcome to our guests today. If you're new with us and worshiping with us for the first time, we would love to meet you if we haven't already. My name is Brooke Weir, and I'm the Kidsman Director here at UBC. As we begin this morning, we wanted to share with you a wonderful outreach opportunity being made possible by the Roxy Theater. They are again bringing to town a movie with a Christian storyline and theme. This movie, Sight, is based on the true story of Dr. Ming Wang, which opened on Friday and will run until Thursday of this week. There's even a matinee this afternoon. We want to encourage you that going to these movies with your non-Christian friends is a great opportunity to begin or to continue a faith conversation with them about Christianity. Have you had a chance to check out our refreshed and updated website? We hope so, and we hope that you're enjoying it as much as we are. The web address is the same as before, uxbridgebaptist.com. Take a look and let us know what you think. We are quickly approaching July, and that signals the start of our summer camps here. This year, we are offering 3 camps at UBC, which includes VBS, Adventure Camp, and Sports Camp. Registrations, along with the details, can be found on our church website and also on the UBC News. We are also looking for more volunteers for VBS and Sports Camp, so if you're interested, please come speak to me or Chriselle, and we would love to get you involved. I'd love to now open in prayer, so would you join me as we pray? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning and for your presence with us. We pray for your Spirit to open our hearts to your word and what your Spirit will teach us today. Thank you for this time now to worship you and for those who are taking the step of baptism and child dedication today. Please be with them and each of us as we praise you today. May you be glorified in all of this. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, it's great to have you here with us this morning. Thank you for coming out to worship. And that's what we are here to do, to worship the one true holy God this morning. God has done great things in our lives, and I'm sure there's many of you who could tell us many stories about that. And this morning, we're going to witness 2 great things. And in Scripture, we have a couple Scripture pieces. Psalm 145 and Psalm 71 says, "Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom." And Psalm 71, "Your righteousness, God, reaches to the heavens. You who have done great things." Let's sing about that this morning. Let's celebrate who God is. Please stand with us.
Come, let us bow at his feet.
God, we give you thanks this morning. You are great, you are good, you are faithful, and we're so grateful for all that you've done for us. Thank you for your son, Jesus, who gave us that freedom by going to the cross for us. God, be with us in the rest of this service, we pray, as we witness a dedication and a baptism, the start of life and the beginning of life as a new believer, God. We thank you and we are grateful. We give you all the praise and glory in your name. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, amen and good morning to each one of you. God has done great things, and it's great for us to be able to share in those together. And what it's just a joy that thrills our hearts to see what God has done through Jesus Christ in his, you know, unspeakably wondrous life. Now he's given it for us as he laid it down on the cross and taken it up again in order that he might be our eternal Savior. And as that has its impact in our daily life, in the events in our lives, we find great joy. We've got a lot to celebrate this morning. It's great to see Mackenzie and Tiffany Green here this morning. There you are, okay? They married just a little while ago. This is Tiffany Meek, by those who... Good to have you here with us. God bless you guys in your new life together. And yes, as we've heard today, we're celebrating child dedication and baptism. So I'm going to ask Tom and Michaela Bowmeister and their family to come on up here on the platform with me. We're excited for you today and really grateful to be able to enter into the joy of God's gift of a new life. Child dedication is not baptism. It's not, come on right up here. Up here on this side, I think, is going to work best. It is not baptism. It is not a prerequisite for salvation. Child dedication is the recognition that God has graciously blessed a family with a new life, and he's trusted them with that life. Of course, God's love is already poured out upon this life. You can come a little closer. That would be nice. Okay. Yeah. And but God gives us the thank you. You're real close. Okay. Can you see through there? I think maybe. Can you see everybody? No, I don't think everybody can see you though. But this is going to be fun. Child dedication is the recognition that God is the giver of life. And we owe him all thanks and praise. A dedication of a child is a setting apart of a child, recognizing that the child is from the Lord. It is a prayer for the child, and it's a pronouncement of God's blessing upon this life. And it's a promise that is made by parents and extended family and the church that we would seek God's blessing upon this child, to raise the child in the love of God, so that this child might be led to faith in Jesus Christ and to the full maturity of Christian discipleship. The psalmist says it well, unless the Lord builds the house, its builders labor in vain. Unless the Lord watches over the city, the watchmen stand in vain. In vain you rise up early and stay up late, toiling for food to eat, for he grants sleep to those he loves. Sons are a heritage from the Lord, children a reward from him. Well, this morning we want to ask Tom and Michaela a couple of questions about their own faith and walk with Christ and their intention here. And then we're going to give you the opportunity as a family to stand together with them and to declare your willingness to support as God gives you opportunity. So, Tommy and Michaela, will you promise to live your lives as faithful examples for Malachi? Faithful examples of love and worship and obedience to God.
We will.
And will you be responsible for seeing that Malachi is nurtured in the faith and life of the Christian community? And will you, by your prayers and witness, help Malachi in due time to confess his faith in Jesus Christ and to grow into the full stature of Christ?
We will.
Now I'm going to ask you as a church family that you will stand together with me, and this will be our way, along with our vocal response, of indicating that we will partner with this family to see God's blessing come. So will you, church family, promise to come alongside Tommy and Michaela in prayer and encouragement to raise this child and these children under the counsel and blessing of the Lord as God gives you opportunity? We will. We will. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you. And, well, I would like to hold Malachi. Malachi, are you going to come see me? Oh. Well, that didn't take long at all. Okay. There we go. Oh, is that a little bit better? Okay. Will you tell us the full name of your son?
This is Malachi Bruce Baumeister.
Malachi Bruce Baumeister. How did you come up with that middle name? I think that's pretty obvious. We're grateful for God's gift. And Malachi, it is our pleasure to dedicate you now in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Let's take a moment to pray together. Our Father, we thank you for this unspeakably precious gift. We thank you for the life that is evidenced here and the life that you give us in every way. We would ask that your blessing attend Malachi, that he would early on in his life come to know you, Lord Jesus, as his Savior and Lord, that you would lead him in the paths of discipleship, that he would grow to be an exemplary person of faith, trusting you in every way. We renounce the works of Satan and the kingdom of darkness and proclaim the victory of Jesus Christ. May your blessing rest upon him. Lord God, we join together now and in the days to come to seek your favor. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you, Malachi. Let's celebrate together with this family. God bless you, guys. We have a gift for you, yes, and the Lord bless you and be with you. Amen. Amen. So it's great to celebrate. And we also have the celebration of life in the Spirit as the Lord Jesus, as the word of the gospel of Jesus comes to our heart and enlivens our heart, and as the Spirit indwells, we have a newness of life. And we're grateful for Elena Mathewson, who has been amongst us for some time now and is now entering into the waters of baptism to testify to the lordship of Jesus in her life. And Sydney Pierce is just a really good friend who has nurtured and come alongside along the way. Sydney does a lot of work with our Haven ministry and also with our young adults or with our youth here. And so Sydney, in this friendship, is going to lead us in the baptism of Elena.
Sermons on Sunday mornings, and I would sing worship songs, but it wasn't always for me.
While this was happening, I was still attending the youth group here at UBC. Watching the community and friendships of the people at youth, I realized the friendships I had were unhealthy and harmful to me. I started listening more closely to what was being preached on Friday nights and on Sunday mornings, taking my faith more seriously. God then gave me a Christian community at school, and these people helped me to realize I didn't need to hide my faith, and I had people by my side to walk my faith journey with. During a youth retreat in 2023 to Muskoka Woods, I was extremely moved by the worship and realized it was the Holy Spirit moving in me. From that moment on, I have been continuing to grow in my relationship with the Lord and giving my whole life to Him. Doing daily devotionals at home, using my gifts to praise Him and spreading His word. I know now that it's not about being accepted into this world, because He has already accepted me with open arms. As I take this next step in my faith journey, I would like to ask for prayer for strength and patience.
Standing for those that are standing, and if you're not, please stand with us. And to go along with that theme, after baptism, as part of our jobs as believers, is to disciple and tell others about Christ, right? And that's what we're going to sing about in this next song. Let's lift this up together.
Oh,
be seated.
Once again, we want to just express our gratitude to the Lord for all of his great goodness to us. And we realize that the blessing of God flows to and through the blessing of God's people. And so again, we want to extend our collective gratitude to you for your ongoing prayer and service and giving here at Uxbridge Baptist to see the name of Jesus lifted high. We're going to just have a moment when we pray, and in this we recognize God's goodness to us. We recognize the faithful response of those who know the blessing of God to give and to honor God. As we give, we honor God and we genuinely express our dependence upon him and our wonder in him. You can give in a number of different ways. We do have offering boxes shaped like churches here in this room, and you can make use of that through your offering envelope. There are also many digital ways, as you see on the screen, that are ways for you to give. We've taken an aggressive budget this year, and I just need to let you know it's been aggressive partly because of what we're anticipating in the summer, where we have more student interns than we've had at any point in our history here. Believing that God would have us invest in the lives of our children, which will be the primary work of these interns, and in the lives of our youth. And so in faithfulness, we are following through with this. But I do want to let you know that our expenses at this point in the year are greater than our income. And what I find is that the people of this fellowship want to know where we stand and then respond with generosity. So understand that we're in a place of a deficit right at this point, and we're trusting God to provide. I want to bring some news from our heart-to-heart team who are in Waigamau right now, some women from Fort Hope, and then our heart-to-heart team in Waigamau. They're excited about what God is doing. They have been running groups of hope with the women there over this weekend and have some very encouraging things that they're seeing in those lives. Grief and sorrow that is being addressed through God's healing word, and it's wonderful to see. We have a report that some of the team members are unwell and could use God's touch to bring strength to their bodies. We're understanding that today in the Sunday school time, there in the church, they'll be ministering to the children with using puppets, and that sounds like a fun time for them. And then later today, keep praying, later today, more of the groups of hope as they wrap up that ministry. So we want to pray together for God's blessing upon our heart-to-heart team. Let me just give you a notice. Next Sunday, we'll be hearing a much fuller report of what God has done through the heart-to-heart ministry this year. Let's pray together. Well, Father, we thank you for the incredible joy and celebrating new life and new life in Christ. We thank you for your faithfulness to us. And Lord, in humble worship, we want to return to you what has first come from you as your kindness and graciousness to us. Bless, we pray, and receive our gifts. Lord, we want to lift up our heart-to-heart team, and we thank you for them, each one. We pray that you will meet them just in the context of the ministry that they are underway with right now. We pray for these groups of hope. We pray for the Sunday school ministry today. We pray for health for the team and ask, Lord, that you'll return them safely to us, Lord, with all things going well and rejoicing in the goodness of God. Lord, hear our prayer. Bless us, we pray. And as our children make their way to their time of teaching now, we ask that you would be with them, that they might, even in their own young lives, sense the joy of the Lord and the goodness of God. Bless those who work with them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So at this point, we're going to ask our children to make their way downstairs, and thank you to those who are serving amongst our children. God bless you. I'd like to ask the rest of you, as they're making their way, if you would take your Bibles, please, and turn to Luke chapter 7. We're returning to our study on Luke. It's been a couple of weeks. We want to get back to our study on Luke. And I'm going to direct your attention to verses 18 to 35 of Luke chapter 7. Verses 18 to 35. And I want to speak today about faith and fearlessness. And the challenge is that we be the people of God, the church of God, characterized by faith and fearlessness. I mean, after all, this is what a baptism testimony is about. It's a testimony about faith, and it's a testimony that I will follow Jesus Christ, come what may, in order that I might walk the walk that Jesus has set for me. I wonder if sometimes you find yourself in the place where you question faith. Does your faith feel weak at times? Maybe you find yourself questioning the biblical worldview. Does it really stand up to the scrutiny that is brought against it? Or maybe it's the ways of God in your life. How is your faith? And in particular this morning, I want to ask this question. Are you sure about Jesus? Are you sure about who he is and who he claims to be? Do you really believe the message of the scriptures? Do you believe that you can base your whole hope and life on Jesus and he will not let you down? Are you sure about him? Or has something come into your life and into your experience that makes you wonder? I think that's the crux of the story that we have before us here in Luke chapter 7. Today, we are looking at a fearless prophet of God whose faith has been challenged by the circumstances that he's experiencing and by the things that he's seeing. In this passage, we have something like a dramatic interlude where the main action of the story is interrupted by a secondary plot, and that secondary plot has to do with the life of John the Baptist. But the secondary plot shines a lot of light on the primary plot. Jesus' ministry has been growing in power. As we look at his miracles and his healings, we see they're getting greater and greater, more and more a display of the power of God. We see his growing popularity with the crowds, more and more people following. And we see the growing opposition of the Pharisees and the scribes. They more and more feel threatened by Jesus and feel the need to do something about it. So we come to this story where the activity of Jesus is interrupted by the disciples of John the Baptist. They come to ask Jesus a question. And in order to understand the significance of this question and of Jesus' answer to the question, we need to ask, well, who is John the Baptist? And what is his significance? What is his place in the story of God? I think our answer comes in this way. I think John is identified by, I think it's clear. John is identified as the greatest of all prophets. He's the greatest of the prophets. John is the GOAT, we can say. He is the one who stands above all others. I want to start just not at the beginning of the passage that we're looking at, but a little further on, verse 24. If you have your scriptures, you can look along with me. Verse 24, where Jesus speaks to who John is. When John's messengers had gone, Jesus began to speak to the crowds concerning John. So here we get Jesus' perspective on John. And he says this, "What did you go out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaken by the wind?" This easily blown about thing? No. "What then did you go out to see? A man dressed in soft clothing? Behold, those who are dressed in splendid clothing and live in luxury are in king's courts." And clearly, that's not where John was. Verse 26, "What then did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I tell you, and more than a prophet.
"This is he of whom it is written, 'Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way before you.'" And Jesus concludes with this, "I tell you, among those born of women, none is greater than John. Yet the one who is least in the kingdom of God is greater than he." John is the greatest of all time, the greatest of all the prophets. We need to understand a little bit of John's role in God's unfolding plan. We call this John's place in the history of salvation. You'll remember in John's early life, he is miraculously born to Elizabeth and Zechariah. They were unable to have children, but God blessed them miraculously, and so this child was born. It was announced at that time that he would be great, that is great in terms of God's salvation plan unfolding. He would occupy a significant place. And we see John as an Elijah figure. That's purposeful. We're told, actually, in verse 17 of chapter 1, he will go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah. John is explicitly named as an Elijah figure. He's rough and rugged. He's dressed in camel hair, a diet of locusts and wild honey, living by the provision of God in the wilderness. His life is an emblem, kind of like an illustration of the history of Israel in the wilderness and then in the exile. And this prophet owns and bears the plight of the people of God. So John's life is a dramatic prophecy, revealing the truth about the nation of Israel in the wilderness and calling an idolatrous nation to repentance and to faith. That's John. He has a ministry of condemnation of sin, and of announcing impending judgment for those who are unrepentant. He was the forerunner of the Messiah who was going to come in and usher in the kingdom of God. Zechariah, the father of John the Baptist, when he finally had his voice returned, said this in Luke 1, 76 and 77, "You, child, will be called prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people in the forgiveness of their sins." John had this unparalleled significance in God's plan as it unfolds. He was a fearless prophet. So he's called to call common people to repentance. He's also called to call the religious elite to repentance. And so he did call the scribes and Pharisees. And he even called the king, King Herod, to repentance. King Herod had taken Herodias, who was the wife of his brother Philip, as his own wife. And John boldly declared that this was against God's law. And as a result, John was accused of sedition. He was bound and he was put into prison. He was put into prison at a place called Machaerus. I have an image here that shows you what that looks like right now. There's buried underneath that is a palace of Herod Antipas. John was put in prison there. It's a fortress palace of this Herod Antipas, east of the Dead Sea, about 260 kilometers from Capernaum, which is where most of Jesus' ministry was being performed. And it was from this place that John sent his disciples to inquire of Jesus. And before long, John was executed there in that place. John was fearless in his proclamation of God's will and God's truth. I want to suggest to you this morning that the world is in desperate need of fearless prophets of God who will speak the truth of God and not hold back. I like the words of A.W. Tozer so much I wanted to read them out to you. These words of A.W. Tozer when he speaks about what the church needs today. And he says it this way, and I've modified it just a bit. He says, "If Christianity is to receive a rejuvenation, it must be by other means than any now being used." We need something different from what we're doing now. If the church is to recover from the injuries she has suffered, he says, there must appear a new type of preacher. And he goes on to say this, another kind of religious leader must rise among us. He must be of the old prophet type. I love that. What does he mean by that, the old prophet type? Well, he means a person who has seen visions of God and has heard a voice from the throne. When he comes, and I pray God there will not be one but many, he will stand in flat contradiction to everything our smirking, smooth civilization holds dear. He will contradict, denounce, and protest in the name of God, and will earn the hatred and opposition of a large segment of Christendom. Such a person is likely to be lean, rugged, blunt-spoken, and a little bit angry with the world. Now, you might find some of that a little bit difficult to swallow. But what we're talking about is a man who boldly declares the truth of God regardless of the consequences. We need men. We need prophets like John the Baptist. I believe it to be true, especially in our day. There's this incredible significance that John has. He is more than a prophet, as Jesus says. He is the one who is the messenger who proclaims the coming of the Messiah. In fact, the last prophet that Israel has is the prophet Malachi. And Malachi himself is the one who's used to anticipate, to prophesy that this great prophet is to come. Malachi 3 verse 1 says, "Behold, I send my messenger," this is God speaking, "I send my messenger and he will prepare the way before me." It speaks about John as the one who is privileged to announce the coming of God himself. God is coming. And he will come in judgment and he will come in salvation. And John is the last prophet before the age of fulfillment of that prophecy. John is the returning of Elijah to call the people back to faithfulness. In fact, it's Malachi again, chapter 4 and verse 5. And I take the opportunity to look this up, where we have these words, "Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before that great and awesome day the Lord comes." John the Baptist is Elijah. This is what makes John the greatest of the prophets. But it's interesting to me that we find John in the situation that's revealed here. John seems to be one who's wrestling with doubt. And so we have this, we have John in his own life dealing with what I would call the battleground of the prophets. Many of the prophets actually deal with just this challenge. Even prophets have doubts. That's interesting. Like Elijah centuries earlier, John was the epitome of fearlessness, none compared. He spoke God's truth to the king boldly, and like Elijah, John was suffering the retribution of the king. John's life was under threat, and he was struggling with doubt. I think it's important for us to note that even the greatest prophet had doubts. Let's look at verses 18 to 20 from this passage, Luke 7. These are just a little bit earlier, verses 18 to 20. "The disciples of John reported all these things to him." That is, they reported what Jesus was doing, what Jesus was teaching. "And John," verse 19, "calling two of his disciples to him, sent them to the Lord, saying, 'Are you the one who is to come, or should we look for another?' And when the men had come to him, they said, 'John the Baptist has sent us to you, saying, are you the one who is to come, or shall we look for another?'" They faithfully repeated the question that John had given them to ask. John has doubts. There's something important for us to learn. John is, you know, things are not going the way John had anticipated. He knew he was the forerunner of the great king who was coming to establish his rule. And here's John, shut up in the prison, he's no longer able to declare what he is called to declare, and he's sinking in some kind of doubt. It's difficult for us to know exactly what's going on in John's life, but it would seem that he's having some questions about what's appearing in Jesus' life. It's an important lesson to learn that having faith does not mean the absence of doubt. Having faith does not mean the absence of doubt. It means dealing with doubt on the basis of faith. We as Christians need to I think it's encouraging for us to grasp this. We deal with doubts on the basis of faith. The scripture, of course, does tell us about the greatness of faith and that we are to be people of great faith. Jesus says in Mark 11, have faith in God. Truly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be taken up and thrown into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that what he says will come to pass, it will be done for him. It's hard to imagine a more clear affirmation of faith and a resistance of doubt. But Scripture also says that we may have doubts. 1 John 3, verses 19 and 20 say this, but by this we shall know that we are of the truth and reassure our hearts before God. For whenever our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart, and he knows everything. What that means is when our heart condemns us, that means doubt begins to step in, and we experience that. But God is greater than our hearts. And finally, and even more clear, Jude verse 22 says this, have mercy on those who doubt. We do experience doubt as Christian followers. But having faith does not mean the absence of it. Having faith also does not mean ignoring the facts. Having faith means being willing to see the facts honestly in the frame of faith. It means sometimes that we have to suspend judgment about what we're seeing around us for the sake of faith, in the exercise of faith. And also we learned that having faith means fundamental trust in the trustworthiness of God. God has been faithful every step of the way. John knows this. And God will be faithful in the steps that are yet to be taken. We need to have a fundamental trust in God's goodness and trustworthiness. God has been faithful in the visible things. He will be faithful in the things we cannot see. You know, there are different kinds of doubts. And I think this is something that we understand pretty quickly. You know, there are intellectual doubts when something comes that challenges the truth that Scripture brings to us. And we find ourselves wrestling kind of on an intellectual level with that. That's one form of doubt. But then there's psychological doubt. And that is when perhaps something in our own experience has made it difficult for us to trust the way God intends that we should trust. And so psychologically, it's a challenge for us to trust. And then there's circumstantial doubt. When things happen in our lives that seem to be, you know, we just find it very hard to reason those out in light of the God that we know and what God has called us to. Circumstances have arisen that cause us to doubt. All of these are real. But in the end, all of these forms of doubt amount to the same thing. They amount to the same challenge. Will I trust in the infinite goodness and mercy of God, in the wisdom of God who is almighty? Will I trust? If you settle that matter, then the intellectual doubts, well, they lose their power. And your phobias, they fade. And your circumstances no longer trouble you, even if they don't change. I think what's going on in John's life here is that he's coming to understand who Jesus is and the perfect way that Jesus is living out the life of the Messiah. And John very likely had some preconceptions that didn't quite align, and now he needs to work that through. John had a preconception that of what it would be like when the Messiah comes, but there's a gap between his expectations and what he sees happening. And he has to work it through, and he works it through on the basis of faith. I think this is just this is just very real. This is what it is to walk the journey of faith. Faith doesn't arrive fully formed in our lives. It needs to be shaped. It needs to be forged on the anvil of God's truth. So it takes time. We wrestle with what God has given us, and our understanding grows, and our faith is strengthened. I was speaking with a few people on Friday night, and one of the things that we were talking about is how following Jesus constantly presents us with the things we need to unlearn. We think we know something, but the more you encounter Jesus, you realize, oh, I have to unlearn some things in order to learn truly who Jesus is. I find it interesting that the greatest of all prophets deals with doubt, but he deals with it on the basis of his commitment to the trustworthiness of God. But then notice this with me. Notice how this passage flows. We come from John to Jesus, and I want to describe Jesus as the nemesis of doubt. Doubt meets its end in Jesus. It's when we turn to Jesus that we find doubt losing its power. I'd like to say it this way. Jesus is where doubt goes to die. Have a look with me at verse 21 of Luke 7. In that hour, now this is after the question that John raised and his disciples presented, after that was done, and then verse 21, in that hour, Jesus healed many people of diseases and plagues and evil spirits, and on many who were blind he bestowed sight, and he answered them, that is the disciples of John, go and tell John what you have seen and heard. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear. The dead are raised up, and the poor have good news preached to them. And blessed is the one who is not offended by me. Well, let me say this. John did the right thing by going to Jesus. In the midst of his challenge, he did the right thing by appealing to Jesus and considering Jesus. And it's very interesting, isn't it, that Jesus is in the midst of doing this. I don't think this is Jesus, kind of spontaneous response to John's question. I think this is just what Jesus was doing. He was healing. He was demonstrating the power of God. In fact, in these things, he's bringing about the kingdom of God just as the Messiah is to do. Jesus doesn't answer John's question with a defensive argument. Jesus' own life and ministry, his action actually, is the defense to John. The miracles, these are not just deeds of compassion, not just Jesus having compassion upon these individuals, but they reveal that he is the Messiah. He is the one who has come of God. It shows his power and his status as God himself who has come amongst us. In fact, Jesus himself had said in his manifesto in Luke 4 that he is going to perform these kinds of things to show that the Spirit of God is upon him and he is bringing about the kingdom of God. Jesus in his own life is the answer to the challenge that John is facing, and he settles the issue for John simply by being who he is. Isn't that beautiful? Just being who he is and doing what he does, what he's intended to do all along. Jesus answers the question. If you're struggling with doubt, Jesus is the answer. And I know that sounds like, a trite saying and easy to say, but the truth is Jesus is the answer to doubt. And we go to him and we find the answers. I like the way that it was put by John Mark Comer in a book called Practicing the Way. Practicing the Way. This is what John Mark Comer says. I am one of many people who have found Jesus of Nazareth to be the most radiant light to ever grace the human scene. I'm an avid reader, he says, and through the gift of literature, I have peered inside the minds of some of history's greatest thinkers. All of them have laudable traits, and some not so laudable ones too. But the longer I live and learn, the more I'm convinced that Jesus has no real competition, ancient or modern. In my estimation, he says, no other thinker, philosopher, leader, philosophy, or ideology has the coherence, sophistication, and the deep inner resonance of Jesus and his way, much less the staggering beauty of Jesus. I think that's very well said. I get a little excited when I find people who say, well, I don't believe, and I think this is a delusion, and here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to study Jesus. I'm going to take a look at the Bible and see what it has to say about Jesus and prove that he is not who Christians claim him to be. I get excited when I hear that kind of thing. It's kind of like the trap is beginning to close on that kind of a person, because when they begin to look at Jesus, when they begin to see what he said, when they begin to see what he does, when the reality of it begins to dawn on their heart, a transformation takes place. and doubt begins to dissipate and faith begins to grow. Because Jesus is the answer to doubt. The antidote to doubt is Jesus. And if you're struggling with it, look to him, consider him, look at his ways, turn to him, ask who he is, and let him speak his answer to you. That's exactly what we're doing as we look at Luke's gospel on Sunday mornings. We're looking at Jesus and who he is and what he means to us. This is the life. This is the life who is the true life, and he is the one who gives us life. It's true encounter with Jesus that actualizes faith. Well, there's something more that we can learn here, and let's just look at this. Let's look at faith itself. Faith is the journey that leads to the fullness of life that God has for us. Let's ask this question. If our faith is going to grow, what needs to happen? Well, I think this is true. If our faith is going to grow, we need to understand the precious nature of faith. We need to understand that faith truly is precious. It is a gift of God. You cannot escape the need for faith. Do you know that? You just cannot escape the need for faith, much as people suggest you can. Everyone has faith in something. Some people will say you can't prove God. You know, they mean in kind of an intellectual sense, something like a mathematical formula. You can't prove God, but you cannot disprove God either. If you don't believe in God, you believe in the meaninglessness of existence. That's the only other option. And I find it very hard to believe that everything we count as important, those things that we celebrated today, many other things, everything we count as important is really just a random, meaningless, insignificant event. How can you live that way? Everyone believes in something. The materialist believes that it's a delusion to think that there's anything more than what we can see and touch and hear. The supernaturalist believes that there is something beyond the material, something more that provides meaning and consolation in life, but it's really nothing more than nature itself raised to a higher level. But the person who follows Jesus, the person of Christian faith, believes that there's an uncreated, eternal, transcendent, almighty, loving, wise Heavenly Father who knows us intimately and who responds to our prayers and who is the source of all goodness and blessing. That's the way we need to live. You need to believe something. Christian faith makes a lot more sense, and it's a whole lot more satisfying than any of the alternatives. Understand that faith is a treasure, and we're to cherish it. Peter says it's more precious than refined gold. That's faith. So you cannot regard it as something that is indispensable. You can't regard it as something that is dispensable. God will someday require an account of our faith. See, let's be reminded that faith is not just something, you know, in our treasure box. It's not just something of value to us. But actually, without faith, we are doomed. We need to understand the preciousness of faith. We need to understand also, as John illustrates for us, that faith needs to be refined. Faith needs it needs to mature and be perfected. Faith is not a finished product, right? Peter says in his first letter, chapter 1, verses 6 to 9, he says this about these Christians who are suffering trials. He says, "In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes, even though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ." It's about faith. It's about the preciousness of faith. And Peter goes on to say, "Though you have not seen him, you love him. And though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls." Faith needs to be refined. And God will put us in circumstances that will refine our faith. And as I scan the room here, I see a lot of faces that represent a lot of stories. I know the stories of our lives. And I know how God has challenged us. God challenges us as a wise and loving Father who purifies our faith. Understand that faith needs to be refined. And if our faith is to grow, we need to understand that growing faith is your responsibility. God sets it before us that we would enter in and see our faith grow. Do not be satisfied with saying, I don't have faith like Abraham. I don't have faith like Elijah or the Apostle Paul. Rather, take pains to strengthen your faith. Enter in and cooperate with what God is doing in your life. Peter goes on in his second letter to encourage that same group of people to add all of the good virtues of Christian life and discipleship in order that their faith might be made strong. Well, how can we do it? How can I strengthen faith? Let me say it quickly. Our faith is strengthened. We enter in and take responsibility for it when we confess unbelief and reject it. When we reject what is contrary to faith. We are to despise the tendency to rationalize. We're to despise the tendency to belittle faith and dismiss faith. Confess unbelief, reject it. And then this, pray for faith. Pray for it. Faith is a gift of God. It's not self-produced. It's not something we work up within ourselves. It's a gift of God. Pray that God will grant you increased faith. God loves to hear that kind of prayer. And here's another way that we strengthen faith. Eagerly listen to the truth of God. Eagerly listen so that your soul feeds upon the truth of God. Paul says in Romans 10:17, faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. It's through hearing the word of Christ that faith comes. As we're doing this morning, give yourselves to hearing the word of God. Let it strike your heart, and faith will grow. Here's one other that I think we should note from our passage this morning. Acknowledge that God is right. In every circumstance, at every point, acknowledge that God is right. He is just. Let's just close out this story by looking at verses 28 to 30, Luke chapter 7. Jesus' words again, he says this, I tell you, among those born of women, none is greater than John, yet the one who is least in the kingdom of God is greater than he. And now listen, when all the people heard this, and the tax collectors too, they declared God just, having been baptized with the baptism of John. But the Pharisees and the lawyers rejected the purpose of God for themselves, not having been baptized by John. This crowd that is following Jesus and hear his words about John the Baptist declare that God is just. And they then conform to the purposes of God. I find it hard to think of a sadder description of a person than what we have here, that the Pharisees and the lawyers reject the purpose of God for themselves. Acknowledge that God's way is right. John warned of God's judgment. John proclaimed repentance for sin and forgiveness for sin when people humbled themselves before God. The Pharisees refused to submit to God's repentance, his baptism of repentance. And their refusal meant that they were unwilling to repent. And it shows that they are what John said they were, a brood of vipers, not the sons of Abraham, and those who will not escape the wrath that is to come. One other thing, how can we build our faith? Well, very practically, take the next step. Take the next step that God has put before you. Act on what you know. Act on what God has revealed to you. Do not be afraid of what you don't know. Act upon what you do know. Act in faith. That's precisely what we see this morning when parents present their child. You know, there are all kinds of things that we couldn't possibly know, but we act in faith, presenting this child before God and pleading for his grace. Or when someone steps forward and says, I declare Jesus Christ my Lord and Savior, and I follow in obedience to the command of Christ to be baptized. Don't question the word, do what it says. Act on what you know. Align yourself with Christ. Align yourself with his way. Serve and give and walk in the disciplines of spiritual maturity. Get busy serving God in his kingdom. Take the next step. You have that opportunity this morning. What is it that God is calling you to? There are a number of things I believe that are essential. Take the next step. Well, let me try to wrap this up this way. You know that I like A.W. Tozer and some of the ways he says things. He speaks about the need for a prophetic voice in our wayward day. And here's what he says. If evangelical Christianity is to stay alive, it must have people of faith and fearlessness again, the right kind of people. It must repudiate the conformists who dare not speak out. And it must seek in prayer and much humility the coming again of men and women of the stuff prophets and martyrs are made of. God will hear the cries of his people as he heard the cries of Israel in Egypt, and he will send deliverance by sending deliverers. It's his way among us. I believe God wants us to be a prophetic church in that way, where we fearlessly declare the truth of God in faith. Tozer goes on to say, and when the deliverers come, reformers, revivalists, prophets, they will be men and women of God and men and women of courage. They will have God on their side because they will be careful to stay on God's side. They will be co-workers with Christ and instruments in the hand of the Holy Spirit. May that day come quickly. Let's pray together. Our Father, we thank you for the life of John the Baptist. We thank you for the way that you have revealed yourself in his ministry and ultimately in the life and ministry of Jesus. And God, how we want to be like Jesus and how we want the fullness of his purposes fulfilled in our lives. So, Lord, today as we have looked at these things, we pray that you would cause the challenge of this to settle into our hearts and that we as the people of God individually and collectively would rise up into the prophetic calling that you've given us. Lord, that your name might be praised, that your purposes might be filled, and that your people might be blessed. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand with us. We've witnessed today a child dedication and a baptism. God is good, and he is faithful. Amen? Amen. Yes, it's wonderful to be a part of the family of God, and it encourages us when we see these things. This next song that we are going to close off with is really a prayer from yourself. It's in the first person. And it's talking about the goodness and the faithfulness of God. Let's make it our prayer to him this morning.
I've been held in your hand from the moment that I wake up until I lay my head. I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my I will. of the goodness of God. Yes, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so good. With every breath that I live, oh, I will sing of the goodness.
I'm sensing that in my heart, the goodness of God. I trust that that's what we are sensing together, recognizing his faithfulness. And I trust that you want to go from this place of gathering in the presence of God out with the purpose of announcing the good news, announcing the goodness of God, and all of that prophetic boldness that God calls us to express. We want to go out with blessing. If you are looking for, if we can help you, if we can pray together with you, if we can encourage you, maybe you're wondering what God has next for you. Maybe you're hearing the voice of God speak to you about some action you need to take, something that needs to change in your life. We want to be able to encourage you. So we have good people up here who are going to be available to pray with you. Please take that, avail yourself of that opportunity. We trust God to continue to work amongst us. God is great, and God is good. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God our Father and the fellowship of his Spirit rest upon each one of you, now and always. Amen. God bless you.